Hi everyone, so today we'll continue with arrays and I will also show you the exam. So let me share my screen. So as I said, today we'll basically talk about arrays. So the arrays are the first data structure that we will encounter in this class. And basically, we start with the opening problem. We want to read 100 numbers, compute their average, and find how many numbers are above that average. Now, the problem with this problem is that you don't know the average until you read all of the 100 numbers. Once you have all the 100 numbers, you can compute the average, but now you need again the 100 numbers so you can actually find how many of them are above that average. So we have a problem of storing and indexing 100 numbers. You have to read all the numbers, then iterate over them to find what is the average, and then iterate over them to basically find how many of them are over the average. You can combine finding the average in reading, because when you read them, you can have a running sum. And you know that there are 100 numbers, so you will divide that running sum by 100, gives you the average. However, you have to iterate again over the numbers to find how many of them are over that average. The solution with what we learned up to now is that you need a variable for each number, which is not a good solution. It will be a very long program in which you will compare every single variable with the average. So that is not a solution. The solution for a compact and efficient code is arrays, where you have one single variable for all of the 100 numbers, and you can use indices in that array to find out each one of those numbers, basically to access every single individual indexed variable. So what is an array? It's the first data structure that we cover in this class. Is a data structure that represents a collection of the same type of data. So that condition that we basically need to access every element, either for assigning a value to that element or taking the value from that element in constant time, in a time that is independent from how many elements are in the array, makes actually this request, this condition that all of the values have to be of the same type of data. So every single location in that array has the same size. So in this figure, we basically see how an array is stored in memory. So we have this statement. This is a statement that declares an array, my list, of doubles. And you can actually see that double open bracket, close bracket is the fact that this is an array of doubles. And my list is one variable of an array of doubles. However, when you define it, it's just a null reference. In order to have a value in that my list, an actual array, we assign to it the value of a new double array of 10 elements. So here we have an initialization of the array. The new double of 10 creates in the dynamic segment of memory, an array of 10 elements. And the address of that array is assigned to my list. So basically the reference is a reference to that array of 10 elements. For every one of the elements, now we can access them with an index. So my list of 0 would be the first element, and we can assign to my list of 0 5.6. My list of 1 will be the second element, and we can assign to it 4.5 and so on. So we have a way to declare arrays, a way to initialize them, and then a way to access either for assignment or for reading from that location an element in the array. The only condition in Java is that the elements are of the same type of data. So if you want to access any element, you can get to that element address, this object in memory, by adding to the reference of that array the index multiplied with the size of an element. So basically, if I want to find my list of 5 in the array, the way that I find the address of this double is that I add the reference of the array with the index 5 multiplied with 8 bytes, which is the size of a byte. So basically, from this reference, from the beginning of the array, if I go 40 bytes, I will find the byte that I'm looking for, my list of 5. And it does, it's basically, it's just an arithmetical operation. Reference plus index multiply with size. So this is constant with respect to the size of the array. If the array has 1,000,000 elements, I can still access an element in constant time because the entire array is kept consecutively in memory. And the only thing that I have to do is to multiply the index with the size of an element to get to the element of that index. That's all. So there are two ways to declare arrays in Java. The first way is the way that you saw in that example, data type of an element, then open close bracket says that this is an array, array reference, for instance, double array, my list. So this defines that my list is an array of doubles. Now, another style is allowed for historical reasons because it was the style used in C, the language before Java, where you put open close brackets after the variable, not part of the data. Now, this is not in the style of Java. The style of Java is that when you define any kind of variables, you first specify the type and then the variable. What you are doing in what we are they are doing in the second case here is a different order. The type is actually interleaved with the name of the variable. The type is at the beginning as the type of the elements, and then at the end as being an array. This style is allowed, again, for historical principles that they basically wanted C programmers to navigate easily to Java, but is not preferred nowadays. In fact, I read hundreds of programs every month and nobody is using this style. But this is a style that is allowed in Java. Now, how do we create arrays? So, declaring the array just creates a null reference. In fact, if we print that variable, my list that I created before, it prints null, N-U-L-L, saying that this is a null reference, is not pointing yet to any array. So in order to create an array, you have to use the new operator, new data type of one element, and the size of the array. So in the case of my list, I can assign to it a new double array of 10 elements, basically a new array of 10 elements, each element of the type double. In this array, I can access every single element with an index, starting with 0 for the first element and ending with the length of the array minus 1 for the last element. So my list of 9 would be the last element of the array. So I have a single variable that actually ranges over all the elements, and they can access any one of the elements with the index. You can declare and create the array in one step. So you can declare an array reference of an array of elements of the type data type, and then assign that array reference to a new data type array of whatever size you want to define. So for instance, my list is a double array, which points to a new array of 10 doubles. Because the other style is still allowed, you can basically also use double my list and then open close bracket. So that's again allowed, but not preferred. Once an array is created, its size is fixed. You can't resize it. An array in Java is basically a static data type that once created with a given size, like 10 elements, you can't add any more elements to it. If you want to have a bigger array, you have to create another array and eventually copy the elements from the old array into the new array. You can find the size of the array using dot length. So if this is the dot operator, you can specify the length property of the reference array, and that will return the length of the array. So for instance, if you want the length of my list, you can use mylist.length, which will return 10. It's kind of like a property of the array. It tells you how many elements are actually in that array. It's stored as part of the variable itself internally in Java. Now, when an array is created, its elements are assigned default values. 0 for numerical primitive data types, the character with Unicode 0 for character types, false for booleans, and null for strings or any other kind of reference types. Okay, so it is a local variable, but the fact is that it's actually a reference to an address in the dynamic segment of memory where objects are assigned values, default values. So by just declaring, like in this example, double my list empty is a new double array of 10 elements, my list of 0, my list of 1, my list of 2, up to my list of 9 are all 0. And you can use them. You don't need to assign to them different values if you do want 0 as the value of those elements. Okay. So the elements of the array have default values. The array elements can be accessed through an index, and this is called an indexed variable. The indices start with 0, and they range up to the length of the array minus 1. Each element in the array is represented using this syntax, which is the array reference variable, open bracket, the index, close bracket. Okay. So when you want, you can assign now to a variable like my list of 2, any value that you want. In fact, you can even assign to my list of 2, my list of 0 plus my list of 1. So it takes the values of the two first two elements in the array and assigns the sum to the third element of the array, my list of 2. Because from now on, those are really like variables. You don't need to, you can use them to read values from it or assign values to it. You can also declare and initialize an array in one step. So for instance, you don't need to write double array my list is equal with a new double array of 4 elements, and then write down that my list of 0 is 1.9, my list of 1 is 2.9, my list of 2 is 3.4, and my list of 3 is 3.5. You can just write it in one statement. Double array my list is equal with this array of 1.9, 2.9, 3.4, and 3.5. This is just a syntactic sugar. It internally, the first thing that it does, it actually transforms into that code that declares, initializes the array, and then initializes every element in the array. Okay. So really this internally is going to be basically parsed into something like this. Double array my list is a new double array of 4 elements, and then my list of 0 is assigned 1.9, and then my list of 1 is assigned 2.9, my list of 2 is assigned 3.4, and the last one is 3.5. So it's just a synthetic sugar. This just gets transformed into this, okay? And now you can do anything you want with those elements. So one thing that you can do is to use the for loop to print them. For every integer I from 0, as long as I is less than the length of the array, and remember, my list.length gives me the length of the array. If I want to print every element, I basically write system.out.println, or even just print the my list of I concatenated with the space. So what this basically does, it prints that array that it was initialized above. So it prints 1.9, 2.9, 3.4, and 3.5, my array that I have above. Okay. Let's see the questions. What does the empty set returns? It's, I actually do not know. So my guess, this will be an array with zero elements and nothing else. I don't see why this wouldn't work. Basically, it's a reference to an empty array. And this, because there are no elements, there are nothing to assign to them to print. What is the best way after initialization? If you want to assign my list to a new set number list, for instance, set it to 2, 3, 4, 5 after initializing to 3, 2, 1. Okay, so let's take one question at a time. So Caleb is asking, if you have an array and this was initialized to 3, 2, 1, and I want to now change it to a different array, and that array is 2, 3, 4, 5. This is a very good solution. Although here, because you don't have the type specified at the beginning, it's not part of the initialization. You have to actually define that this is a new array of doubles, which is 2, 3, 4, 5. So the only difference is that you have to specify the type. If you try to do what you proposed, that you had an array, inline array, and then you want to assign it to a different inline array, because the variable is not declared in the same line, you have to actually use, you have to specify that this is a new double array of 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay, Justin has a different question about this problem. So in this problem, the question that Justin had was, what is I less than my list dot length? So this is a for loop, and it says initialize first I to 0, then at each iteration check if I is less than the length of the array. My list dot length is 4, because that's the length of that array. 0 is less than 4 is true, so it will print out my list of 0. Then it increments I to 1. 1 less than the length of the array, which was 4. 1 less than 4 is true, so it will print out my list of 1. It increments I to 2. 2 less than 4 is still true, and it basically will print out my list of 2. I is incremented to 3. I 3 is less than 4 is still true, so it will print my list of 3. I is incremented to 4. 4 less than 4 is false, and we finish the program. So it's basically just comparing the index in the iteration in the loop with the length of the array. So this is a standard way to print the elements of the array. Good. Let's continue. So basically what's happening when you call the constructor explicitly, the constructor will convert the list of numbers into an actual array. Exactly. So basically the same thing that you saw in the lecture notes that happens right at the beginning, that reference is the assigned the beginning of that array. The same thing happens when you are assigning to this double list, the list that contains the array that contains 5.6, 4.5, and so on. It's basically that you have, you create an array, not you, Java creates an array with that number of elements, assigns to the each element the corresponding value, and then it gives the reference of this array to the mylist variable. Yeah, in all cases, the same thing happens, exactly this figure. Okay. So here is an example. For instance, my list is assigned, it's an array of doubles, is assigned 1.9, 2.9, 3.4, and 3.5. This is just equivalent to double, my list is a new double of 4 elements. My list of 0 is assigned 1.9, my list of 1 is assigned 2.9, my list of 2 is assigned 3.4, and my list of 3 is assigned 3.5. So let's see an example. So for instance, we are given this code and we are asked to analyze it. So the first line basically defines an integer array values, which has the reference of a new integer array of 5 values. So basically values will be a reference to an array after it's created that contains 5 zeros and has the indices 0 to 4. So now you can basically continue the program. So I is initialized to 1. 1 less than 5 is true. So value of 1 is assigned 1 plus values of 1 minus 1, which is values of 0. So values of 1, which is actually the second element, is assigned the value of I, which is 1, plus values of 0, which is 0. So 0 plus 1 is 1. Then we increment I to 2. So now 2 less than 5 is true. And values of I, which is 2, is equal with 2 plus values of 2 minus 1, which is values of 1. So 2 plus values of 1, which is 1, is 2 plus 1, which is 3. And this continues. I is incremented to 3. Now 3 less than 5 is true. Values of 3 is equal with 3 plus values of 2, which is 3 plus 3, which is basically 6. I is incremented to 4. 4 less than 5 is still true. Values of 4 is equal with 4 plus values of 3. So 6 plus 4 is 10, and that's assigned to values of 4. I is incremented again to 1 is 5. 5 less than 5 is false. So we finish the for loop. And we assign to values of 0, values of 1, plus values of 4. Values of 1 was 1, values of 4 is 10. So values of 0 will be assigned 11. So the state of the array after this entire program is executed is basically that the array is 11, 1, 3, 6, and 10. And the best way to trace this program is with a pen and paper, basically. Draw an array of 5 elements and then the variables I, and then you can see how it modifies at every step and keep track of what's happening, kind of like debugging, but manual debugging. Any questions about this example? Okay. So my list in this example is how do we initialize an array with input values? For instance, I want the user to enter the values that I want to put in that array. So the best way to do it is that you create the array, you know exactly how many elements you need. So you can ask the user to enter exactly that number of elements and then write a loop that iterates from 0 to the length of the array and ask the user to enter every value of every element of the array. So basically it will iterate over the elements and every element is assigned input dot double dot next double. Okay. And then you can print them. So let me actually show you one thing in this program. So first thing that I'm gonna do is to declare a new array of double. Let's say that we have 4 elements, so we have a limited number. I'm going to use the printout later. Next, let's define a scanner. For the standard input. Okay. Then in a for loop, expect the user to enter the values. So basically it's from the user that they have to enter the values system. Enter 10 doubles or 4 doubles, I'm sorry. Let's actually use plus my list dot length, concatenated with doubles. So now the user will enter the 10 doubles. We are going to read them. So my list of I is assigned input dot next double, and then we are going to print them in the next line. Okay, so in fact, I can show you that you can add, you can still run them all into one single line. I forgot the semicolon here. So enter four doubles, 1.9, 2.9, 3.4, and 3.5. And then it basically printed all of them. So even if you enter one at a time, basically all of the four, this for loop will read the first one in my list of zero, the second one in my list of one, the third one in my list of two, and the fourth one in my list of three. Okay. Now, let's say that I don't want to enter from the user. I want to actually generate random values. So I can use math.random. And let's say that I want random values between 0 and 10, not including 10. So now I can basically see what do I get. So I get four different values in that array, totally random. Every time I run it, I will get different values. Okay. So this is a random generator, an array that generates random elements. Okay. It's actually one of the problems in the second homework, where you have to write a utility library for arrays. Okay, so this is the example. You want to initialize the array with random values. You basically can iterate from 0 to the length of the array, and every element my list of I is assigned map.random multiply with 100. Printing arrays. So one way to print them is to use a for loop that iterates over the indices of the array. So for every index I from 0, as long as I is less than the length of the array and increment with one after each iteration, print my list of I. So this will basically concatenate with a space so you can see the elements. Sometimes you can concatenate with colon space so you see them separated. Okay. Summing all the elements in an array. So you define a variable total, and as you have the elements in a for loop, you add each element to the total. So in our case, let's say that we also want to add all the elements to the total. So I can define before the random generator a double total equal to 0. And then the total is incremented with the value of my list of I. So now when after I print the array, I can also print out what is the total. So I can print out that the total is the total. If I want the average, I can do that too. So basically, for the average, I can divide the total with the length of the array, my list.length. And this basically gives me the average. The count is easy. It's just the length of the array. So count is my list length. So now this not only generates the random array, but also computes the total sum of the elements in the array, 9.7 plus 3.0 plus 4.8 plus 0.4 is 18, 0.189 and so on. Average is basically 4.54 is basically 18.189 divided by 4, and the count is 4. There were 4 elements generated in the array. Okay. So now, one thing about arrays is that there is another type of for loops. So let me tell you about that, and then actually let me do the largest element. So If you want to find the largest element in the array, you can do it as follows. You can assign to a maximum my list of zero, which is the first element of the array, and then iterate over all the rest of the elements from index one to the length of the array. And if any element is greater than the current maximum, then the maximum can be assigned my list of I. So let me actually do that too. For that, we need another loop. So after we did that printing, we can find the maximum. So first we need a double for maximum. And in fact, I will do both maximum and minimum. So my list of zero is the maximum. And the minimum is also my list of zero. And then inside the loop, I can do the following. If my list of I is less than the minimum, then the minimum is assigned my list of I. Else, if, let me actually do it here, if my list of I is greater than the maximum, so maximum is less than my list of I, then the maximum is my list of I, otherwise nothing else to be done. So basically we finish the for loop. So now we can actually also print out the maximum and the minimum of the elements in this array. So first the minimum is min, and the maximum is max. I can do them both in one single loop, because if it's less than the minimum, then it's definitely also less than the maximum. If it's greater than the maximum, it's definitely greater than the minimum. Initially, they were the same. Okay. So now this is my array, 0.28, 0.62, 1.9, and 6.5. Minimum is 0.28 and maximum is 6.56. So they were correctly computed. The largest element and the minimum element. So you always start from one of the elements, not from zero, because it may be the case that all elements are negative. So in that case, you will say that the maximum is zero, but that's not true. It's the maximum of the elements, even if they are negative. And you can put them minimum and maximum. Random shuffling. So you are given an array and you are asked, give me a permutation of this array, a random permutation. This is also simple. What you can do is iterate from the index zero to the length of the array. For every value of I, generate also a random index j. So j is math.random, multiply with the length of the array, cast it to an integer. This will give you indices in the array between zero and the length of the array not included. So for every I, you also get a random j. Then you swap the two elements. So you define a variable temp double, which is assigned my list of I. Now my list of I can be assigned the value of my list of j, and my list of j assigns the value, is assigned the value of temp. So basically for every index, it generates a random other index and it swaps the two elements. And it starts from the beginning up to the end of the array. So this will give you a totally random shuffle, like basically a permutation. Even elements that were swapped once, they are swapped again later when we get to that index, okay? So that's why it's a pretty good random shuffling. And again, let me show you an example. So let me clean up the code a little bit. So we have printing the array. We have the random generator. Let's leave these two. So we have an array. We basically have we printed it once. Then we want to randomly shuffle it and then print it again and see the difference in the array. So we have two prints of the array. And this will now print the same two arrays, and we need to print ln so we can actually see the two arrays are identical. Print ln. Okay. So now if we run it, it just prints the same array twice, and we can generate a random permutation. So again, we start with every index from 0 to the length of the array. And now for every index, first thing, we generate a random index. So let's say j is the integer part of math.random. Multiplied with the length of the array. Okay. Now we define a double variable temp, which is assigned my list of I. Now my list of I can be assigned my list of j, and my list of j can be assigned temp. So let's see what's happening. So in the console, you can see that the original array was 8.2, 4.6, 3.7, and 6.5. And now we get the first two elements swapped and the last two elements swapped. But if we run it a couple of times, we see sometimes it stays in place and other elements stay in place. This was actually quite interesting that the swapping didn't do any effects. Sometimes the elements are sorted in different order and so on. So it's really a random generator that basically swaps the elements quite randomly. Does this give you an uniform probability for every shuffle? Yes, if you generate, I would say, 100 times the shuffle, you will see that you get almost every possible permutation with equal probability. You rely, that's true, on the random function, but that's relatively random. It's pretty random. Cool. Shifting elements. So there are actually two shifts. You can shift the elements to the left with one position, or you can shift the elements to the right with one position. So the one that you see here is called shift left. So how does it work? We save the first element, my list of zero, in a temporary variable. Then in a for loop that iterates from one to the length of the array, to every element at index I minus one, we assign the value of my list of I. So for I equal one, my list of zero will be assigned the value of my list of one. So we basically copy the second element into the first, then we increment I, then my list of one is assigned the value of my list of two. So we basically copy the third element in the second element, and then the fourth in the third, and so on up to the end. For I being my list of length, dot length minus one, the last value of I for which this condition is true, my list of length minus two is assigned my list of length minus one. So basically, the last element is copied into the previous to last element. After the for loop terminates, we copy finally the temporary variable in which we saved into the last element. So my list of my list dot length minus one is assigned temp. Okay. So this is what is called shift left and rotate, because you actually also take the first element and put it at the end. It's not only shifting the elements to the left and rotate. Okay. So let me show you an example again. So consider that we have one array, and this time I'm going to use a standard array, 1, 2, 3, 4. And we want to do shift and rotate. And maybe I should do it in a separate method. So I'm going to start writing methods for this. So public static void shift left an array of doubles, double A. Okay. Double array A. So basically the algorithm there said define a double temp in which you assign A of zero, the first element. Then write a for loop that iterates from I equal one up to I being A dot length, I plus plus, A of I minus one is assigned the value of A of I. And finally, A of A dot length minus one, the last element, is assigned temp. So that's shift left. We can also do the printing separately. So public static void print takes a double array A. And there are two ways. So one is the way that we were printing before using indices. Another way is just to iterate with the for each loop. For every double V in the array A, print out the value. Print the value V, concatenate it with a space. So that's a second type, that's a for each loop that we'll discuss in a couple of seconds. So now, basically, we can see the effect of shift left. So my list that was 1, 2, 3, 4, shift left, my list, and print array, my list. Which basically, what does it print in this case? It prints 2, 3, 4, 1, because basically it shifted left and it rotated, it put it at the end. Another kind of shift is rotate right, the shift and rotate right. So basically public static void shift right, the double array A. Now, how do we do rotate right? We have to save the last value and iterate from the end to the beginning to copy the elements. Otherwise, if you iterate from the beginning, you're copying 1/2, then 1 again/3, and so on. So we need a double again temp to save the value of the last element, A of A dot length minus one. Then we need a reverse for loop, an integer I that starts from the end, A dot length minus one, as long as I is strictly greater than zero. Greater than zero is good, yeah. And I is decremented with one at every step. And A of I is assigned the value of A of I minus one, the previous element. And finally, A of zero, it's assigned the value of temp. So this is shift right and rotate. So if instead of shift left, I shift right the elements 1, 2, 3, 4, 4 comes at the beginning and 1 is the second one, 2 is the third one, and 3 is the last one. So shift right of my list will basically print out 4, 1, 2, 3. So we save the last element 4 into a temporary variable here, then we iterate it from the beginning from the end to the beginning. And for the last element, we assigned the previous to the last element, A of I minus one. And we went up to I one, because for A of one is equal with A of zero. Finally, A of zero is equal with temp, which basically did the rotate that put the last element at the beginning. The one that we saved here, we put it at the beginning. So that's shift right. Now, enhance for loops. It's a very good point. So now I can see in the chat that Greg, you proposed that you use that we can use my list of five modulo the length of the list. So I assume that I'm not quite sure what you guys are talking about. List modulo n. For example, if the list has three elements, I'm sure that Greg is right. Okay, thank you. Good. Okay, since Java 1.5, there is a new type of for loops called for each loops. And for each loops work without an index variable. And the idea is that instead of writing for and then the index from zero to the length of the array and iterate with my list of the index, you can just define a variable, double value, the same type of the elements that we have in my list, and basically use it, that variable to iterate over the entire collection. The advantage of this way to print elements or actually to access and use the values of elements is that you can basically iterate without an index. And you can iterate over any collection. It doesn't only work for collections that are arrays. It works on array lists, on any other type of collections. So in general, the syntax is element type, for element type, and the variable that you're going to use, colon, and then the array reference variable. So basically the same an array of the same type of elements of the same type with element type. And then you can process the value. So here, the only thing to be careful about for each loops is that you don't get a reference to that element in the array. So you cannot use that value to assign a different value to it. You can only use it to read it. So you must still use an index variable if you wish to traverse the array and change the elements in that array. So this enhanced for loop only works as a read-only mechanism to iterate over the elements of the array. You can't actually modify the elements of the array using a for each loop. So some of the loops that we learned before, like for instance, a loop that computes the sum can be transformed into a for each loop. So that old loop can be written as double total for every double D in the list, the total is incremented with D. And you can see that it's more concise and it's also better because you can actually iterate in the same way with the same exact program over any collection in the Java collection framework. Printing arrays can also be done with for each loops. So again, similar to the previous program, for every double D in my list, you print the value of D. And this is how we did it in our method. Summing the elements for each loop, we already saw it actually in two slides ago. Here, this was the method for summing. Copying arrays is another problem. So often in a program, you may need to duplicate an array. If you just use the equality operator, what happens is that the two referencing are pointing to the same array. So before the assignment, maybe list one was a pointer to some list, and list two was a pointer to another list. After the assignment, both list one and list two are pointing to the same array. So don't copy with equal, because if you modify the elements using one reference, those are also seen through the other reference, okay? So it's really that now you have two references to the same array in memory. What you can do to copy an array, you can actually create another array. So you have a source array, which contains, let's say 2, 3, 1, 5, 10. And then you can create a target array, which is a new array of integers of the same source array length, the same size. For every index from I equals zero, if I is less than the length of the source array, the target array at index I is assigned the value of source array at index I. So what this basically does, copies every element into the corresponding position in the target array. And it iterates over all the elements from index 0 to the length of the source array, which is the same with the length of the target array, because that's how we actually created the array. Is there an advantage for each loops beside aesthetics? Only that, only conciseness, and the fact that it's more, you would iterate in the same way over an array list. Later this semester, we'll learn about array lists, and one advantage, so it's a different syntax you would need for a normal for loop to actually have get instead of using the index notation. If you write it with a for each loop, the loop remains the same. You don't need to actually do anything else. You would use the same syntax. Caleb is asking, using a for each loop guarantees you don't modify the array also. In all both cases, yes, that's true actually. You are right. You can't modify with a for each loop the array. So it's also maybe a way to ensure that the user doesn't modify the array. Okay. If you don't want to write your own copier of arrays from a source to a target, you can actually use system.arrayCopy, which takes the source array index, the position from where it starts to copy the elements, the target array, the position in the target array, and the length. And then it basically copies the elements from the source array into the target array. One thing to be careful about is that it doesn't create the target array. So you still need to create yourself the target array. Okay, that's the only thing that is extra. So if you want to actually copy an array, so let's say that we have the previous array that we have above, and I want to use that utility to create another array that is a copy of my list, I have to declare double my list two. It's a new double of the same size with my list dot length. And then I can use system dot array copy. The source is my list. The position is from position zero. The destination is my list two. The position where it starts in the destination is zero. And the length is my list dot length. Okay. So now if I print my list two, it basically, you will see that it prints the same elements one, two, three, four. Because what we basically did, we copied from my list all the elements into my list two. But really, that's the same with writing the loop yourself. So index I starting from zero, as long as I is less than my list.length, I plus plus my list of two of I is assigned my list of I. So this has exactly the same output that the previous program has, because this is exactly what this method does. It iterates, but it iterates, you can actually give a different index to start with or a different number of elements. So you basically can parameterize what do you want to copy, what subarray. Okay. Now, when you pass an array to a method, you are actually passing the reference of that array to the method. So one thing that we learned last class was that if you pass by value, call by value, a method, and you change the variable inside that method, the outer variable doesn't get changed. For arrays, it's exactly the opposite. Because when you call with an array variable, a method, you copy the reference to the same array from one variable to another variable. So both references are still pointing to the same array. So if you do modify into that method the array, then it basically When you come back from the method, the value is modified. Okay. You can either pass an element, a reference to an array, to a method, or you can create an anonymous array on the fly and you pass the reference to that method. So this is the similar to what we saw when we initialized an array with an array like new double array of 1, 2, 3, 4. This is new integer array of 3, 1, 2, 6, 4, 2. It's called an anonymous array because it has it was given no name in the main method. In the main method, you call the print array method with this array, which is materialized on the spot. It has no variable name. It will have a name in the print method, but in the main method is basically anonymous. Okay. So this statement creates an array at runtime by specifying the type of the array and the elements of the array. There is no explicit variable to this array, and that's why it's called an anonymous array. So pass by value or call by value basically means that when you pass arguments to a method, you pass the value of that argument. Now, there is a difference between primitive types and arrays or any other reference types. For primitive types, the actual value is passed. So if you change the value of the local variable inside that method, it doesn't change the value of the variable out in the main method or in the caller method, the parent method. However, for an array, the value that you pass is the reference to actually the array in memory. So if you change that array inside the method, it will affect the original array, even outside the method, because the same, there are two variables which are referring to the same object in the memory. Okay, so let me show you an example. In this example, we have two variables. X is a primitive type variable, is equal with 1, and Y is an integer array of 10 elements. I pass both X and Y to a method M. So the method M takes X and copies the value in number, and takes Y and copies the value in numbers. However, X is the value 1, so number is 1. Y is the reference to the array that has 10 elements. So that address is now copied in numbers. So numbers is pointing to the same array of 10 elements. To number, which was basically initially the value 1 of X, we assign 1001. To numbers of 0, the first element of the array numbers, which is referred by the numbers reference, and so it's also by Y, we assign 5555. We finish the method M, we return back here, and we print the value of X, and we print the value of Y of 0. What do you think is the value of X? One, excellent. So, and that was exactly what we said last time, that although we changed that variable value in local variable to 1001, it is still one in the main method because this was a one directional copy. What do you think that is the value of Y of 0? So Y was copied into numbers, we modified numbers of 0. What will be the value that is printed? Y of 0 is what? Excellent, 5555. And the reason for that is that both Y and numbers are actually an address, but they are address of the same array in memory of 10 elements. So modifying numbers of 0 in the method also modifies numbers Y of 0 in main. So that's the difference between arrays that you can modify in a method and primitive type variables, which you just copy the value. The same copying works, only that X was a primitive variable and Y is an array, okay? So this is actually showing what's happening. So we have the stack, which we execute the main method, and Y is a reference to an array, which is in the heap, and X is 1. And we call the method m. And the method m, basically we pass the value of x to number, and number later is assigned 1001. And we pass the value of y, which is a reference to that array in the heap, to numbers, and numbers of zero is assigned 5555. When we finish the method m and we come back to the main method, x is still one because it was only copied into number, and y of zero is 5555 because it's a reference to a location in memory that was changed by the variable numbers. Strings are immutable, so it doesn't apply to strings. It applies to string buffer. So strings are, once a string is created, you can't modify it. Basically, you can assign a different string address to the original string, but you can't modify the string. For multi-threading purposes, you want basically objects that are created as much as possible to make them immutable. But there is a different type called string buffer, which is basically like a string, but you can modify it. It has methods to modify it. For string buffers, the same will happen because you can pass a reference of a string buffer to a method. That method can add characters after the string or can modify a character. When you return, you have the new string buffer. Excellent. Good. Now we can write more methods. So the next method is reversing a string. You can write two types of methods. You can actually modify it in place. Basically, you don't return anything, you return void, and you just modify the string. You can use a temporary variable, copy the first element into it, assign to the first element the last element, and then assign the temp to the last element. And you can continue this to swap all of the elements up to the middle. Or another way is to basically return a new array with elements reversed. So in this example is basically the second method. We pass in a list. The result is a new array of the same length with the list for integers I starting from 0 and j starting from the result.length minus 1. So here we have two variables in the loop. As long as I is less than the character, the length of the list, I is incremented with 1 and j is decremented with 1 after each iteration. The result of j, which is basically the last character because it's the last character in the result, is assigned the value of list of I, which was list of 0. And you continue like this from the beginning of list and from the end of result, and you copy all of the elements into the result, but in reverse order. So basically, a list list one was an array, and now list two is the reverse of list one. It doesn't, list one is still the same array, but list two is 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, is in reverse order. You can rewrite the method reverse to modify the same array. So here is actually how this works. So we call it with this original list, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. First, result is created with an array of the same length, which is basically an array of 6 zeros. Then I is 0 and j is 5, the length minus 1. So now, since 0 is less than 6, is true. Result of 5 is assigned list of 0. So basically, we copy the first element in the original list into the last element of the result. We increment I to 1 and decrement j to 4. Since 1 is still less than 6, result of 4 is assigned list of 1. Then I is incremented to 2 and j is decremented to 3, and 2 is less than 6. So now we copy list of 2 into result of 3. And this continues, and we copy all the elements in reverse order in the result. Now, since I became 6, the condition is false, and we return the result. So basically what happened is that now the result is returned to list of 2, and we are back in the main method. As I said, you can also have a different reverse, a reverse that changes the current list. So you invoke it with list of one, and then list of one is in reverse order. So the difference here is that we divide by two. So it's the same I and J. The only thing is that by swapping, we basically go up to the middle. We basically assign the first element to the last element and last to the first, and we go up to the middle. Why do you think we don't go up to the basically the length of the list? Why don't we just say from index zero to the length of the list, do this swapping? What do you think would be the effect? What would be the result of the list? We swap them back. So basically, exactly. So we swap them up to the middle, and then we keep swapping them to the original position from the reverse string back to the original string. So that's why we need to divide by two. And that will basically give us the correct swapping. Okay. Very good. Okay, so now searching elements in an array. So the searching is the process of looking for a specific element. So for instance, let's say that we have an array of integers and we want to find a key in that array of integers. Okay. So let's actually think together, how do we implement a linear search method? So we have an array. Let me delete everything else. So we have an array, let's say this array, maybe a different array, 4, 5, 2, 1, 6. And I want to find out if an element is in the array. So I want system.out.println. And here I invoke the method linear search with my array, my list, and the key. So the key, let's say, is one in that array. And if it is, what is the index of one? So this is the method that we want to implement, public static int linear search that takes, in my case, an array of doubles and a double key. So linear search, basically, it's in the name. You start from the beginning and you search for the element. When you find it, you return the index. So for integer I starting from zero, I is less than the length of the array. I is incremented with one at every position. If A of I is the same with the key, we found it, return the index I. Now, if we search through the whole array and we didn't find the element, the key, then return minus one. Because we basically want to see the case that if somebody says, what's the index of 7 in that array? We want to say that there is no 7 in that array. It's not there. Minus a negative index tells us that it's not there. So now we can run it. And we can see that it tells us that 1 is at the index 3 and 7 is not in that array. So this is linear search. Basically, iterates with indices over the entire array. And for the first index for which A of I, the element at I, is the same with the key, returns the index. If that is not found, it returns minus 1. That's linear search. So basically, if I had some array of integers, I was looking for the key 3. I start comparing. Is 3 equal with 6? No. Is 3 equal with 4? No. And continues like this with elements that are not equal with 3 up to 3, and then returns the index of that. So that's linear search. And this is the method for integers arrays. Binary search. If the array is already ordered, then it's cheaper to find an element by looking instead of in n time of the size of the array, looking in logarithmic time. So think of a phone book. Phone books basically have all the phones, let's say, in some zip code area. Now, instead of reading the phone book to search for a name, you usually go directly to the letter for that name. So for instance, you are looking for Fodor, you basically go to F, somewhere in the middle of the dictionary, in the middle of the phone book. Similarly for binary search, if the array is already sorted, then instead of looking in the array from the beginning to the end over all the elements, you can look directly in the middle. And if the element is, if the key is less than the element in the middle, you can directly discard all the elements up to greater than the element in the middle. You can discard half of the array at once, because by transitivity, if any other element that was greater than the middle is also greater than the key. So, and you continue the same process. Now you look in the middle of the remaining array, and again, discard half of the array, and look in the middle of the remaining array, and then discard half of the array. So at every step, you compare the key with the element in the middle of the remaining array. Now, the number of steps that you will perform in this case is logarithm in base 2, because at every step you get half of the array out, logarithm in base 2 of the length of the entire array. And that gives you the number of comparisons, maximum number of comparisons, because if you find the element, then you can basically return the index and you are less than the logarithm. So this is the three possible cases. If the key is less than the middle element, then you only need to search the key in the first half. If the key is equal to the middle element, then your search ends with a match and you return the index. If the key is greater than the middle element, you only need to search the key in the second half. So you discard the first half. So here is an example. I'm looking for 8 in this array, a sorted array. So I compare, is 8 greater than 4? Yes. Good. So now I discard the first half. Is 8 greater than 7, which is approximately the middle of the remaining array? Yes. So you discard everything less than 7. Is 8 equal with 8? Yes. And you return the index. Okay. So that's basically the idea. So binary search takes an array and a key of elements of the same type, defines two variables, low and high. Low is 0 and high is the length of the array minus 1, the two ranges basically from the beginning to the end. If high is greater, while high is greater than low, the middle is the average of high plus low divided by 2. If the key is less than the element least of middle, then high becomes middle minus 1. If the key is equal with least of middle, then you return the middle, because that's actually the index of the key. Else, low becomes middle plus 1. And you repeat this until either that you found the key and you return the index, or high is not greater than low anymore. Basically, high was decremented with 1 and is less than basically low, and you basically didn't find it. In each case, you return a negative value, minus low, minus high, minus low, minus 1, which actually gives you in negative where the element should have been in that array, but you didn't find it. So this is actually a negative number telling the user that we didn't find the element, but it also tells us that if it would have been there, it would have been at this index in positive. Now we return the negative index. So that's basically the binary search algorithm. And here is an example. So this was an array of 13 elements. So the indices were between 0 and 12. We were looking for 11. The array was sorted. 11 is less than 50. So in the first iteration, the high will become 5. The index was 6 minus 1. So now we are looking in the middle of the remaining array. So 5 divided by 2 is 2. So we compare 11 with 7, the element at index 2, which is greater. So low becomes middle plus 1. So now low is 3. Middle is the average of 3 and 5 is 4. 11 is equal with 11, and we can return that 11 is at index 4. So this is how it works, binary search. So basically, it always looks in the middle of the remaining array until it finds the element or doesn't find the element and tells us that it is not there. It only works on sorted arrays. So remember this, that binary search only works on sorted arrays. Here is another example. I'm looking for 54 instead of 11. So 54 is greater than 50. So the low becomes 6 plus 1. Now 54 is less than 66, the element in the middle of the remaining array. So now the high becomes 8, the middle is 7, and the index is 7, and 54 is less than 59. So the high becomes middle minus 1. And now the while loop terminates because high is not greater than low anymore. And it also tells us that the index of 54 should have been minus 7 minus 1 minus 8, which is not quite actually true because it should have said minus low, but it's negative and that's all that matters. There is again a method that exists in Java, arrays.binary search, which does exactly that for you. So it basically searches the index in a list of that array. Any questions? Okay, next, selection sort. So you are given a random array and you want to sort it. So selection sort is one of the methods of sorting. There are many algorithms of sorting, selection sort, insertion sort, quick sort, radix sort, and so on. Now, selection sort is actually quite simple. It says, find the minimum of the array and swap it with the first element. Now, the minimum is in the right position. There was nothing else less than it. So you have to sort the rest of the array. And you apply the same algorithm. Find the minimum of the rest of the array, swap it with the first position of the rest of the array. So 9 comes here, 2 comes here. And now the prefix is sorted. And again, you apply the algorithm for the rest of the array. So you continue like this. Next minimum is 4, so it's swapped with 5. 5 is actually the minimum of the rest of the array, so it stays in place. 6 is the minimum of the array 8, 9, 6, so it's swapped with 8. Then 8 is the minimum between 9 and 8, so we swap it with 9, and we got the sorted array. So the idea of selection sort is that at every step, you find the minimum in the rest of the array, and you swap it with the first element of that rest of the array. And then you continue with the rest of the elements after that position. Okay. So you can basically start implementing it. For every position in the array, starting from the beginning to the end, find the minimum element from position I to the length of the array, the last element, and swap it with the element at index I. So that's two steps. So minimum, you basically have to save the minimum. You start with the minimum being list of I, the index of the minimum being I, and for every index from j being I plus 1 to the length of the array, if the current minimum is greater than the list of j, then the current minimum is list of j, and the current minimum index is j. So you repeat this until the end of the array, and that gives you in current minimum the minimum between index I and the end of the array, and the index is in the variable current minimum index. So now, in case that the current minimum index is different than the position I, you swap it. So the current minimum index element is assigned list of I, and list of I is assigned the current minimum. This is the entire selection sort method. We stop here today because basically, and this is all that we are going to test for in the in the exam. So the exam will be on Monday, and the topics, which I should probably put on Piazza right now, are everything that we covered up to now. Basically, all the chapters up to arrays sorting, selection sort included. So topics end with selection sort of arrays included. That's basically the topics for the midterm one. If you want to actually try to do a sample midterm, there is one in Blackboard. It will have all type of questions. You are basically, you can see here, this is a question. If you attempt to add an int, byte, a long, and a double, what's the result type? It's a double. That's the biggest type of those. If you attempt to add an int, byte, long, and a double, you will get a double. So you will get for every solution after the exam, after you finish the exam, what was the correct solution, okay? Even if you did it correctly or incorrectly. Try to do this sample exam. The questions in the real exam are not the ones in the sample exam, but they are similar. So it gives you an idea what to expect from the real exam on Monday. That's all for today. Any questions?
Will there be any questions where we have to write code?
Yes. So if you did the sample exam, you will see that there are questions that you are basically asked to write code, like rotate right. Well, basically here is the requirement, write a complete void method, rotate right, that takes two parameters, an int, an integer array called numbers and an int n, shift by n positions to the right. Now, the easiest way to do it is to shift n times by one position. So yes, there will be questions in which you have to write code. There will be multi-choice questions like the ones that you saw before. There will be questions in which you basically are given a piece of code and you are asked to write exactly the output or exactly the value that is required. So fill in the blank, multi-choice questions, write complete code. Yes. Yes, of course. So for the longer question answers, you can write helper functions. As long as you define your functions and you write them all into the answer, you can basically implement it in any way you want. Only implement what's required. So for instance, if there is no main method required, then do not implement it, okay? I think when I pasted this problem, it mangled it a little bit because I remember that it was much clearer. It basically said, do not implement the main method, but I see there something that happened. So let me write here. Yeah, it basically says, do not write a main method at the end. So I have to be careful when I copy the questions into this to actually be written correctly. Okay, any other questions? Okay. So that's basically it then. Good luck in the midterm and if you have any problems, I will be on Google Meet for office hours during the midterm. So if you have any issues during the midterm, let me know. Okay. Thank you very much, everyone. Bye, everyone.